to the Batcave.
Greetings, everyone. How about it? You hear me, Strider?
Yeah, I can hear you. It's caught on.
Well, I guess time will tell. I've been getting echo. Oh, they're straightening out, I hope. What's been up to?
Trying to, just meditating, looking at the world, trying to enjoy myself.
Trying, huh? You're doing something wrong. Oh, by the way, this is being recorded in case you didn't hear it begin at the start.
That's fine. I don't believe I have anything to hide.
I mean, if you do, I believe you're fooling yourself. And you don't
anyway. I think everything in the universe is out there to know. So, how can you hide anything?
Exactly. Like, you know, most people got nothing that I haven't seen before. I got bored. I figured I was going to have a call, maybe see anybody joins in. I put up a few invites, see if anybody's paying attention. I was going to play the soundtrack from Roots of the Matrix. If we get...
I know what you're talking about.
I come with I got a DVD set with all the Matrixes, and this was the one that came with it. I don't know if you heard it, but I thought it was interesting.
I don't believe I've heard it. No.
Yeah, you might be able to get it off the internet. If not, I'm probably going to record it or play it over the air here, over the internet. Put it on one of the calls sooner or later if I get around to it. See, I don't think I've started a call in the afternoon like this to see where it goes. Last call
It's been a while since you did an afternoon call.
The last call I started went on for 6 hours.
Were you just playing music or was anybody on it?
No, they were on it. I played some music in the beginning, a little bit here and there, and wound up going for 6 hours, man.
Did you have a good cut? Were there fruitful conversations?
I'd say so. It's on there. It's recorded. So.
The last call I heard was with a man from the so-called England, who was gotten to the point where he had a house that he was using, and the bailiff who kicked him out twice had actually become really good friends with him now.
that's been I've had a few more since then.
That call was inspiring. It was very pleasant to listen to.
I'm waiting to hear from Goody. See if he's gotten out of jail or not.
Where is Goody from, and what's the situation?
He's out there in Illinois.
I find that the more it's gotten to the point with me where the more I stay away from Skype, and especially some of the threads that they've started, the boot camps and other stuff. The more I feel my soul tends to go into turmoil when I'm listening to other people in turmoil or watching other people in turmoil, and so I've been clearly trying to do a good job of avoiding that. So basically, I've just been trying to enjoy everybody else and everybody around me, and try to be at one with everybody. You get on some of those calls and some of those discussions, and everybody's turned their own beliefs into their own, I think, like his wife says, their BS, their belief system, is their own little box. And trying to talk to somebody who's, working from a box, who's inside a box and isn't willing to, peek out and see what's outside of it, can be frustrating and detrimental to your spiritual health.
Yeah, I know it happens to me all the time. That's why I'll listen to them calls, and that's what happens. It inspires me. I got to go start a call, man. These guys are too depressed, and usually winds up having a good call.
I know I can be off. I haven't listened to any. It's not personal. It's nothing personal. I haven't listened to your call. I haven't listened to anything of Boris. I haven't listened or pretty much read anything in closing in on a few weeks now. And I've really just been working on myself and just being happy wherever I'm at and trying to make it, changing myself instead of worrying about everybody who's around me.
There you go. Embrace your pain.
Yeah.
Embrace the pain.
Study. Just been reading a little bit about ancient mythology and how all these belief systems go back thousands and thousands of years, and
since the beginning, if you ask me, it's everybody's got an opinion. And, who's right and who's wrong when it really comes down to it?
I give up. I think supposedly, allegedly, Socrates said, I'm the smartest man in the world because I realize I know nothing, and that puts me one up on everybody else.
Yeah, because, it's like, remember, you're always dealing with a superior opponent.
And if you the problem with getting into those discussions and getting into the worst part would be getting into arguments is that now you've engaged in an argument. It's almost like you're saying I'm superior. And it doesn't have to be what you're saying, but it definitely can turn that way on a dime.
Well, if you let it, that's where the art of staying at the bottom comes in. You know what I mean? It comes to a point, I'll push people here and there and see where they're going. And then after that, when I see where there's no sense in trying to get the point across through questions, I let them have their way. And who am I to argue with what they believe?
And then you talk about music or something that has... let's talk about something that's not going to mean anything.
Well, it all means something. The point of the matter is how you deal with the situation at the moment, I like listening to people. I catch it. In fact, the one guy, you'll hear a call kind of like that. It's a couple calls back from the last one, if you get a chance. There's a guy come on there. He fucking knows it, man. He led me to believe he knows it. So that's okay. Who am I to argue? He could be 100% right for all I know. But the thing was, you come to a point, we come close to here and there, you got to know where the limits are, And that's where, when you realize where the limits are, it's coming from the gut, you know what I mean?
Right.
Where you want to go,
I've pretty much come to the decision that I'm comfortable and happy where I am right now, with who I'm becoming. I'm not going to push anything, try to find the agent or do anything like that until I feel it's the right time.
There you go.
Right now it doesn't feel like the right time. Right now I'm actually a little, I feel very comfortable and very happy. So why would I want to go change anything right now?
Why rock the boat, man? I agree. I'm getting to where I'm getting antsy again, so who knows?
Yeah, I heard that a couple calls back. In the last call I heard, you were like, maybe it's time to get out of the bat cave.
Yep. Who knows what I'll do. You know?
Yeah.
It's just, but no, I hear you, man. If you're comfortable where you're at, because I tell you, these calls, man, listen to them and getting on them, and most of these people on a lot of these calls are at war. And
it's very scary. I think some of the calls that I have heard in the last few months is one of the reasons why I backed off and just decided to work on myself, is because, man, these agents are dealing with absolute lunatics. And when I go to talk to them, you know, I want them to be sure that I want them to know and be able to see in me that I'm at peace and there's no you know, I don't mean any harm. I'm here to help.
Well, the only way they're going to know that is if you know it.
Yep. Well, and that's what I'm working on.
Yep.
You know? I mean, that's not something that's ever, that's a journey that you're never, that has no ending. It's a journey that you're gonna suffer through forever. Yeah. You're always gonna be learning something new.
Yeah.
And you know, I know popular religion doesn't talk about it, but you know, classical mythology and all that fun stuff talks about the journey and not the destination. Yeah. So to me, it's all about the journey. We'll see what I decide to do, and maybe I'm just going to enjoy this 95 to 97 degree so-called Atlanta heat for a few months, and then maybe I'll do something, or maybe I'll wake up tomorrow and have a wild hair up my ass and decide to do something. Who knows?
Yep, there you go. Because, hey, I've been doing, you know, studying this shit for years, man, and heck, I've just been giving people the opinion the way I look at it, and I have yet to make the move. I believe they already know me here. Point of it is, am I really prepared to win the lottery? And if I, will I get that far? Am I truly listening to the heart, or is the ego still running the show? I mean, until you come to that conclusion and are confident with it, why go push it? If you're comfortable, why rock the boat?
Yeah.
You know?
I also had to deal with some stuff, because I know my with me going through this process, it's my wife really didn't want to have anything to do with it at the beginning, and now recently her spirit started to hurt. Like, you know, she's, you know, where am I gonna, what, you know, what do I want to do? And you know, now she's starting to, another reason why I don't really want to rock the boat right now is she's starting to come around and starting to ask good questions. So, you know, hopefully I can help her. Hopefully I can, you know, we can walk the road together, and hopefully I can try and bring her up to speed as much as possible.
You get what you put out. I think you'll find that if you're truly, I believe truly on the path to stay in honor, it's going to show through everyone that, you know, meet you. It's going to come back.
Yeah, she's one thing she talked about recently is starting her own business. And I told her, I said, well, I know you want to do this, and we have the means to do it, and it's fine, and I support you 100%. But, you know, keep in the back of your mind that when this starts happening, as successful as I believe it's going to be, do you want it to be yours, or do you want it, or do you want to give it back for the good of everybody?
Well, the thing of it is, I think if you're doing it for the good of everybody, get a reward. See, a lot of people get hung up on just using Federal Reserve notes as a crime and stuff and all that. The thing of it is, are you doing it the way you understand it, and are you doing it out of love and honor, or are you doing it because you believe you own something? You know, are you believing you're better than somebody? That's really, in my opinion, the more I learn, is what is the true intentions? Is it coming from the heart, or is it ego saying, look at me, I got all this money, I'm better than everybody else. Nobody gave me everything, I earned it. Okay.
Well, whatever. she's had business ideas in the past and run with some stuff, and some stuff didn't work out, or it did work out because it wasn't supposed to work out, you know, just it was the path that she was supposed to be on, but what she's looking at right now is something that she absolutely loves. And I told her, I said, as long as you're doing what you love, you're going to be happy. So, you know, just enjoy it, you know. I'll give you 100% support. You know, just let's make sure that, you know, let's make sure this is for all the right reasons. So, you know, check your heart, you know, constantly check your heart to see what the, you know, see why you're doing this.
Right, listen to that intuition, and, you know, it seems to me a lot of times women got a little better grasp on it than men anyway.
So, oh, yeah. She knows when there's something wrong with me before I know when there's something wrong with me.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all good, man. You know, enjoy it. Like I say, if I wasn't sure what I was doing, I'd probably go out, get another job there and work for the so-called Federal Reserve Notes and whatever, if you know, gotta do what you're comfortable with, you know?
Well, I'm out there, I'm out here 5-6 days a week, putting in the 8 hours, sometimes 9, and it used to be a job, but what I found out was the reason why I wasn't happy with a quote-unquote job is because I wasn't happy with myself. And as soon as I became happy with myself, well, it's 95 degrees out right now. I'm walking around outside, and it feels freaking good. You know? And I'm getting Federal Reserve notes to do it. So,
well, whatever. You know, the thing of it is, Federal Reserve notes make some people happy. The thing of it is, I think the big issue is, you know, it's not the so-called money, the so-called Federal Reserve notes that are evil. It's the love of them that's evil. Would you cheat your brother to get a few extra ones, you know, things like that? That's what it really comes down to, if you ask me. But then again, what do I know, you know?
I don't have a problem using the Federal Reserve notes, you know. Right now we have enough. We have enough to do what we need to do. No more, no less. We're not hoarding anything. Pretty much everything goes back to, you know, goes out the door when we get it. So, you know, I think we're using it properly.
Well, you're comfortable with it. You can sleep at night. You don't feel like you're screwing your neighbor. I mean, that's a good start, if you ask me.
I mean, it's a nice feeling once you start realizing the answer is inside yourself and not outside yourself. It's not in all these guru books, or it's not in all these lectures or everything. You know, all the answers are inside of you. It's just a matter of going in there and getting them. You know, and listening to the being able to discern, you know, which one is from the heart and which one is from the head. Because the ones that come from the head can sound awfully like they come from the heart sometimes.
Yeah, but usually the first thing that comes across is usually from the heart. Now, it may not be all that loud or whatever, but let the ego and the intellect start, you know, the intellect and the emotion start talking you out of it, you know. Well, it's going to cost me money. Oh, is it? Or could it, like, the way you do it and be in love and honor, could it bring you more customers? They always said word of mouth is the best advertisement. People love them, you know.
That's one thing. One thing I've keenly been aware of, you know, as long as I've been in business is, I've done some traveling overseas, and it seems to me, my opinion, my opinion is that people in this country, because of the people who own businesses, because of the love of money, try to put on these unbelievable facades, you know, your impeccable customer service, which when I look in my heart, I can see right through it if it's phony and you just want my money, where you go overseas and you might not have this impeccable customer service, these smiling faces, like all the commercials and everything, but they actually do the job, get the job done, and I feel comfortable with that. It's, you know, I don't know, there's the phony, I believe I've always been able to read through that phoniness of somebody who's just being nice because they want a separate, you know, they just need some Federal Reserve notes or they desire them. And I think that if you're just genuinely taking an interest in people, then, you know, they want to deal with you.
It'll take care of themselves. People who are doing it in honor, in my opinion, aren't out there telling you they're doing it in honor. They know it by their fruit, and people are saying, these people, you know, they come here and they do what they say they do. And it's word of mouth. It'll grow.
Yeah.
People got to say, yeah, we're the best, number one this many times, and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, those are the ones you watch. But they gotta, you know, what'd you bring that up for? You got a guilty conscience? When did I ever accuse you of being dishonorable? That's why I try to get across to people, man. You walk into these courts, man, and you start telling all this shit, I'm not this, I'm not that. What are you even bringing it up for? There's only one reason I'm in that court, is to be a witness, because I believe there's a problem, and I want to help my brothers and sisters settle the matter honorably. What more do you need to say than that? And then just, you know, question time until you both can agree on something. Other than that, keep asking the questions. It's simple.
One thing in business, too, is I think I've noticed that, in my opinion, I can really tell... You can really tell somebody's heart by the way they treat their employees. If they have employees, quote-unquote employees, how they treat them. Because I've seen a lot of people who, you know, they'll, to the customer's face, and even after the customer's gone, oh, that's the greatest customer in the world, they're awesome, you know, they'll definitely come back. And then they turn and start screaming at their employees.
Yep.
And it's like, well, there's a disconnect here. Yeah, how can you, you know, that you're treating that person this way because you're getting Federal Reserve notes from them, and you're treating this person this way because you're giving Federal Reserve notes to them? You think there might be a correlation?
Yep. That's honor, man. One friend of mine, she runs a business. I think she's finally realizing how to deal with her employees, whereas, hey, we work good together, man. The more money we make, the more you get. Treat them with honor. But if you're there dicking on them all the time and think you're something special, them guys are going to screw you sooner or later.
I took one of those management courses, quote unquote, years ago, and one thing one guy said was, he said, your employees are your first customers.
There you go. That makes sense.
And I was like, wow, yeah, if you look at it that way.
Your employees, you know, they're the ones that usually are meeting the customers, and if they don't believe what you're doing, where do you think that's going to get you?
And then I had another, now here's the opposite side of the coin. I had another guy who was teaching management who told me, you have to look upon your employees. The best way to deal with them is to look upon them as if they're wounded and sick. And they need to be treated as if they're wounded and sick. And I'm like, well, didn't you just, now I've just placed myself above them? And
did you, or is it they need help?
Well, they might. I don't believe the way I comprehended what he was trying to say was, my understanding of what he was saying was that they are beneath you. Now, I could have taken that the wrong way,
maybe they need help because, you know, maybe some of them do. Maybe some of them just like having a job. Maybe some of them are just getting a job because, you know, you can look at that a number of ways, if you ask me. Some people are just getting a job because they need one, and whether they like what they're doing or not could be a whole other story, and that could be maybe what he meant by wounded and sick.
Right.
That's one way. But I know where. Yeah, I agree where you're coming from too. That's a good possibility. You know, looking down on them, and I like to look up, man. Like I tell people, I like staying on the bottom. That way, if you know, I just hope I have enough sense to get out of the way when they fall.
If you're asking good questions, you're gonna learn something from everyone. Yeah. something. It might be something positive. It might be something negative that you're going
to
seek to avoid.
Listen to what people are saying and stay on point with them. Get to the heart of the matter. That's all. That's why it says you need not prepare when you go before these people, these judges or whatever. You need not prepare. The point of
that
the
is,
matter.
Yeah, that's one of those hard things though, because most people want to. Most people aren't listening to what the person is saying. They're thinking about what they're going to say next.
Yep.
And if they think about what the person is saying, they'll get the information that they need to say what they say next, to say what you say next.
Exactly. That's the way I look at it. I agree. Listen to what they're saying, man, and say, okay, now you can take what they're saying, and you got a point, man. You can take what people are saying and go all kinds of ways with it and really take control of the situation just by keep asking the proper questions.
Yeah.
That's the way I see it, anyhow.
No one else want to come on this call or what?
I don't know. I can send it out. Who knows?
I like the talking multiple people.
I got the word out there. I think they're scared of talking to the Batman. I'm on a boot camp right now, and I put in a couple offers. And some people think it sounds like somebody's baiting me and all this. Well, we got Zero and we got Jesus there. I think you've talked to them or know who I'm talking about maybe there.
Yeah, I believe I know who you're talking about there. But I put in a
talkshoe there, and they go, wow, looks like bait. Zero put in there. Oh, looks like bait. Here, fishy, fishy. Here, fishy, fishy. And Zero, I put in live now. I put it in there. Still looks like bait. Who is the master of that bait? And I put in there, are you calling me a master baiter?
Yeah, I was on that boot camp for a while, and then someone brought something up, and someone brought up the subject. It was just, it was just accused. Seemed to me like they were accusing their brother and everything. And I tried to ask questions about that, type in questions, and is this what you really believe? Might the problem be with you? Instead of answering the question, they like picked out one word. They picked out one word in the question and started concentrating on that one word. Oh, are you calling me this? And it's like, if you're not going to answer my question, I'm done here. Because
Think of it as thinking the way you asked the question.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean,
it was an accusatory question, and I try to get away from that more and more. But if somebody's a real dick, then
Was it? I mean, was it an accusatory question?
Yeah. Think back what you said.
Oh, I said, I think the question was about the name. The name was created. The man. I assume it was a man. The man on the call said that the name was created to trick us. The name was created, was created with the intention of tricking us. And I asked a question like, I can't remember the exact question I asked. Was something like, are you sure, or something like that? And then it was like, well, who are you? Well, who's you? But we're done here. I'm not gonna sit there and say is. And then type out the name that the person, that the man's using. Sure, it's like I think you understand what I'm saying. So
it sounds like you're getting awful offensive. If somebody asks me, "Who are you?"
Yeah.
Answer them with a question. Well, what do you mean by "Who are you"?
Well, who's somebody?
What are you looking for here? That's all.
Well, there were two.
What's your name?
There were two men having a conversation. If two men are having a conversation and you say, are you sure, to the other person, it's possible that
I recall
you could politely answer the question, maybe.
Well, maybe you might have broke the ice a little different. I think if I recall, you said, are you sure you're not the problem? Right?
I don't remember.
I think you said something like that. Maybe I'm wrong.
I don't remember. I'm trying to put it out of my head as soon as it happened because I don't want it festering and bothering me. That
it's not so much there's things we got to look at the way we talk to people, because that's how we learn to stop frustrating ourselves, in my opinion. And like I try to tell people, that think of the question you asked, and if somebody asked you that question, would it offend you? And work with that. Try to stop being that way. In my opinion, it's more fruitful, you see.
So if I ask the question, are you accusing your brother? Instead of saying, are you making an accusation? Are you insulting me? It's better to start playing semantics.
But the point of it is, how can anybody insult you?
I didn't think it was a fruitful conversation.
Well, did you give it a chance to grow? You got to water. You got to treat these people with tender love and care, man. I'm learning it more and more. I'll tell you, I'm not the best at it. Well, I believe I'm not anyway. But I'm working on it. And I find a lot of times the questions I ask can be very offensive. And they're, you know, who's starting the war there? Then, you know?
Yeah.
That makes any sense.
Yeah.
We're all working on it, man. You know.
The same man gave me firsthand knowledge. You know, straight from him typing, saying that, you know, when he was pulled over by a cop, he asked the cop, who was he, you know, why was he dressed in a costume?
Well, that's asking for trouble, man. Like, you might as well call him Bozo the Clown.
Yeah, so, I mean, allegedly they hosted their own internet radio show for a while. So, I mean, I just got the feeling that I wasn't, you know, they knew everything they needed to know, and I wasn't, you know.
I know where you're at, Strider. I've done the same thing, and it frustrates the hell out of you. It appears to me it has, and it did. You know, I used to get frustrated over that shit too. You gotta let it go, man. I know what you're saying. Well, you don't got to, but I recommend it. Put it that way.
Well, for me, for where I'm at, because, you know, the only person who knows where I'm at is me. For right now, I think it's just I'll work on myself, and you know, if anybody else needs any help, they can ask. But I'm not gonna try and go just volunteering.
That's kind of where I'm at now. I don't go out of my way anymore, except like I do these back calls every now and then. As far as going out of my way, I'm over it. Because there's a few calls that I could go back to, and they might have me on it, they might not. But I'm not, you know, if they want to call, I'll go on. But the back calls are out there, and I figure hopefully they're doing some good, you know.
Work on yourself, love everybody else, and shouldn't be too many problems.
Love yourself first, most of all. That's the hardest.
There's different schools of thought on that. There are some schools of thought that say that the best way to love yourself is to love other people.
Yeah.
Because if we're all one and you love everybody, then you're loving yourself.
True, but it's part of it. But the thing of it is, until you're at peace with yourself, can you truly put out peace towards everybody else? You know, you may appear to here or there, but just like you were talking about that conversation you had, sounds like you got offended, and you know. And if you can get offended, are you really at peace with yourself?
You're never going to be 100% at peace with yourself. It's always going to be a fight.
I know, but you can get better at it when you realize.
Yeah, you can get better at it.
You know.
Well, did it? You know, was I offended, or just did I not see it going any place positive? Or was it 8:30 in the morning, and I was scheduled to be at work some in the next 15 minutes?
I guess that's up to you to decide,
huh? Yeah.
I'm gonna play a song here quick here.
Okay, that's cool, because I might have to hook this phone up for some charging.
All right, well, I was gonna play a song.
Okay, go ahead.
And I'm just gonna play the song. If you're still there, good. If not, I guess I'll play some more music.
Songman, sing your song until the morning comes. I can listen as long as you can say. Songman, can you teach me how to make someone feel good? I think I'll have a song or two that I might want to sing like you someday. When I was young, he'd come around from time to time. He could really make that old piano ring. I remember how my daddy smiled a certain kind of smile with every song his little devil sing. Songman, sing your song until the morning comes. I can listen as long as you can say. Songman, can you teach me how to make someone feel good? I think I have a song or two that I might want to sing like you someday. He'd sit there in the parlor with a twinkle in his eye, laughing as he had a taste or two. Then all of us would gather round and listen in. He'd play a song he ever knew. He'd sing of old times and simple rhymes. He'd sing of Lady Fair. One song always made my mama cry. But with every tune he'd fill the room with cowboys, clowns, and kings. You could almost touch them if you tried.
Alrighty, we got some callers in here, Strider. I unmuted you. Greetings. You guys want to hear the rest of the song?
Yeah, I'm here.
What's going on, Batman?
I give up. What's going on?
I don't know. I ain't figured it out yet.
Yeah, it makes two of us. I'm stuck in the bat cave here trying to figure out where the door is. Anyway.
Hey, I checked out that movie Revolver.
Yeah, what do you think?
Holy egos, Batman. That was a good movie.
I thought you might enjoy it. Yeah, if you... I had to watch it. I don't know how many times I watched it. In fact, started watching it again the other day, and things still pop out of it. That's some movie, man.
Yeah, I watched it one day, and I watched it the next day, and then I watched it the next day. So I got three times under my belt, and I probably will watch it a few more times.
Interesting concept. Did you get the one where at the end of it, all the guys with PhDs and all that bullshit come in and give their opinions on it?
Yeah, that pretty much solidified the deal for me there. If a PhD means anything.
Yeah, post hole digger, man. I got experience with that.
So do I.
I just, it's all written on the heart, man. You know, what do you want to do with it? I think we know most everything that there is to know. The thing of it is, are we listening? Huh?
I believe that. PhD is piled higher and deeper.
Well, there you go. Works for me. That way you get better flowers. Yeah, I thought I was getting bored here this afternoon. I figured I'd start a call and see if anybody cared to join in.
I seen the email come through, so I'm here at work doing my thing, and I figured I'd call in since I got your email.
Cool. I figure if there's anything for discussion, we can bring it up. We'll go for it. See if we get anywhere on it.
Hey, Batman.
Hey, Rhonda. How you been?
Been good. How you been?
I'm still breathing, so I guess as good as anybody else.
That's right.
That's right.
I just want to thank you for inviting me. I got your invite the other night. I didn't get on the call, and I thought, get a hold of Batman. I haven't talked to him in a while.
Yeah, I wonder how you're still hanging around with that Keith Livingway.
No.
I just wondering if you were. I'm wondering if you ever got over the ego yet. It was.
Got a hold of the what?
Got over the ego yet? You know, got a handle on the ego.
Well, not the last time I talked to him. I don't think.
I went to one of his seminars, man. I kind of met him. It's just.
I won't say. I learned. I believe, you know, I learned some things.
Oh, so did I. I learned from him too. Yeah, no doubt.
But you got it. You know, I don't believe one group or one man has all the answers.
Did you ask him? I bet he knows them.
Well, that's why we don't talk anymore.
I figured. I was wondering what happened to that call you guys had going there for a little bit.
Yeah, he thought it was a team effort, you know, a group effort, and. You know, anybody that ain't worth talking about it. Like I say, I appreciate the things he did teach me, but you just got to use discernment to know, you know, what part of the pie somebody has.
Well, what got me when I went to that thing, he talked about silver and stuff, I believe, at one time, right? And when I went to the seminar, I offered to pay with silver, and they wouldn't take it. I thought that was funny right off the bat, but anyway.
Huh.
Other than that, yeah, I don't blame you. I mean, you know, there's no need to. In fact, I'd welcome him to the call. I'd love to go round and round with him. I think it'd be enjoyable, enlightening.
Yeah. I think he was having some trouble with the bullseye out, you know, in his neck of the woods, and he got arrested there around last Christmas.
Well, Jones. Man, he's kicking God in the dick, as Boris likes to say. My opinion, if you're claiming ownership, you're looking for trouble. I don't know if you listen to many of the calls we got out there on the talkshoe, but.
Yeah, you know, and I agree, you know, with, I agree with that concept. You know, there's a difference between claiming ownership and claiming right to use. You know, in my humble opinion.
Even a right, claiming a right to use is claiming ownership, if you ask me.
I don't see it that way.
Well, what rights does anyone really have? What rights does anyone really have, if you think about it, other than the choices we make at the moment? And are those rights, or are those thoughts that occur, you know?
No, I believe we have rights. That was given to us by our Father, our Heavenly Father.
Our Father? Or is it just the creation and we're all part of it?
For the Creator, you know, without getting nitpicky on words.
Well,
I know words are important.
Well, to an extent, it's words help you get to a meeting of the minds. That's all they're really good for.
Well, I figure He created me, so, you know.
All right. So if He created you, then what rights do you have?
Well, I have the right to. I believe life is love in action. I believe my name is love. I believe that's our the Creator's name's love, and that's who we are. We are love. We not We don't, love is not a commodity or something one has more than another or does more than another. It's who we are. It's the, you know, they say a name is that which is given to property by the owner thereof. So, you know, when we're in this world,
Could a name be tagging the property thereof?
Tagging, as in labeling or, well.
You claimed a name, you just realized you're
Right, I don't have a name. I'm called, when I'm in this world, I'm called, or I am known as, I don't have a name. The name that I have is love, and that's because that's who I am, but because I'm created by my Father.
But a name's still a sign of ownership. To me, love is an action we do, how we treat one another.
Love is, in my opinion, who we are. And,
that's,
we are embodied. That's who we are.
And can you love everybody unconditionally? Then you're telling me you love everybody unconditionally, right?
Me?
Yeah.
Do I love everybody unconditionally?
Yeah.
I've been trying to do better.
I hear you.
The last few years, you know, I've been trying to recognize, I've been trying not to be judgmental. I've been trying to lead by example and not by just telling people what to do. But do I make mistakes? Yes, I do.
I'll join the club, huh?
Yeah.
I'm too. The point of the matter with rights, I don't know, it's like a thorn in a claw. You know? Rights to me is claiming ownership, and any form of claiming ownership is a dishonor to me.
Well,
you know?
Yeah. I wish I had more organized here. I could get into it with you a little bit more. Maybe on another call we can. But we'll just have to agree to have a different viewpoint at this point on that.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a learning process. I'm learning. I don't know everything. I try to ask my Creator to guide me and lead me to what's right and show me what's right. But, you know, we all have to use discernment, and because we know other things are always trying to creep in.
Well, just creep in. Could that be the ego leading you to believe that?
Oh, yeah. Okay. I think the ego is a very dangerous thing.
It can be your best. It's ego to me is like the government. George Washington, I think, wrote it. So I'm told, but it's like government. Government can be like your best friend or your worst nightmare. You know what I mean? I'm just paraphrasing here. That's kind of what I got out of it.
That's like dogs can be a wonderful servant and a dreadful master.
Yeah, well, there you go. That's something like, I believe, George Washington wrote. And I believe the point of that matter is who's running the show? Are you in balance? Is the ego in balance with the heart? Or is there discrepancies here and there, you know?
I think the ego can't cross the threshold into the Sacred Heart. Because I think only our pure selves can do that. That's why there's guardians at the gate. To not let that ego in, to have that kind of power that Christ said that can move mountains, because somebody with an ego won't take into consideration the people living at the base of a mountain before he moves it. And
right.
I think that's the ego.
Well, the way you can do great things is through the heart, through the love, through the honor, staying in honor. The ego, though, is there. You know, it's hard to explain the way I look at it, but the ego's there to test us. Like,
I mean,
you know,
just look how powerful love is when they wrote. Look at all throughout history, the songs, the things that have been written about love and the power of love, and I've been blessed enough to be able to witness it with my own eyes and feel it, and that's what strengthens my foundation in my belief.
Oh yeah, it's all learning. We're all at different stages on the big old circle.
We're all connected.
I like the yin and the yang point of view. You know, without the white, you wouldn't know the black. You know. And the thing of it is, can you count it all as joy and stay in honor? The more you learn to stay in honor with yourself, you'll find you stay in honor with all those around you.
Yeah.
Remember,
yeah, I think, though, in the beginning, there was only light. And the further we got away from our true selves, then shadows, which is an illusion, you know, darkness is an illusion. I believe,
yeah,
you know, in the beginning, there was nothing but light. And then when we strayed away from our home, shadows had to come in to give us definition.
Could that be when we claimed ownership?
Well, I'm not claiming ownership of things. I'm claiming ownership I do believe I have intangible rights that...
Is that claiming ownership? Could it be when we started claiming ownership? Well, I don't know about you, but I claim ownership. I still do it every day. You know?
Well, I don't claim ownership. I claim, you know, more of these days, I would call it, you know, my right to use. My right to use the space that I'm standing in.
Think about what you're saying. By saying it's my right, is that claiming ownership?
I'm not claiming ownership of the land. I'm claiming of my ownership to occupy that piece of it where I'm standing.
Well, and what's the difference?
Because.
You're claiming. Claiming.
No, because if I'm not standing in that spot, then I wouldn't. Then that piece of land no longer has any meaning to me as far as that I have a right to it.
It's not,
you know,
whether you...
As long
as
I'm standing in it, as long as I ain't trespassing on somebody else's right of use of where they are, then I have it, you know, if I'm standing out on the road, you know, I mean, not standing in the middle of the road, of course, but you know what I mean. I don't have to claim ownership to where I'm standing if I'm off of where I domicile at.
You know what I like to say lately? If you believe you have rights, you believe you have the right to breathe?
Yeah.
You do. Well, ask a dead man that.
Well, maybe, you know, I don't believe in death, actually. I believe we only have one life, and it's forever. These are just chapters of our lives. And, you know, I think, you know, they used to say...
Wait a minute. You're confused.
No, wait a minute. Here's a good parallel. They used to say you can never avoid what? Death and taxes, right? Well, we know taxes is a fraud now, don't we?
Who said it's a fraud? Taxes to me isn't a fraud. Taxes are totally lawful.
Well, yes, they're lawful to in certain situations, but as far as having a...
I thank God for taxes. It shows me who's claiming ownership.
There you go. Think about it. If you believe you're paid a tax, you're claiming ownership, right? If you're just using everything, how are you paying a tax?
I'm confused by your question.
If you own nothing, how can you be taxed?
Well, is tax doing? Tax is taking away Federal Reserve notes? Are the Federal Reserve notes yours?
Or are you just using them to get what you need?
Yeah. Oh, you're going to take,
no,
oh, you're
no,
gonna take them away?
The,
well, maybe
the
I can,
Reserve,
then I'll get some more.
The Federal Reserve notes private money.
See,
you know,
that's ownership. If it's private
money. I'm not claiming it. You know,
Patriot,
don't jump on me.
Patriot.
I'm not claiming it.
Well... Not claiming it, but you believe you're paying.
Jump on the Federal Reserve. They're the ones that say they own it.
Wait a minute. You're believing you're paying a tax, though.
No,
if
I'm
not. If you're believing you're paying a tax, that's claiming ownership.
I don't. I didn't say I was paying a tax.
Oh, okay. What was you saying?
Said taxes are a fraud.
I said taxes are, you know, we've learned, let me put it this way. I might have misspoken. We have learned over time what taxes are and what they're not.
Who's we?
Yeah.
okay, I have got more educated over the last 10 years about what taxes are
and in your
and they apply to.
And it's your opinion,
don't.
Right? And
that's
it's your opinion, right?
Okay, cool.
That's what she said. What she okay. believes.
Cool.
She said it's a beating a dead horse. Go ahead, Rhonda.
What was he talking about? Lost my train of thought.
Taxes.
Oh. Taxes. Think of it as
well,
if you're
basically what I was saying was that my point was, if do you pay taxes?
Me? As far as
yeah.
I know. How could I pay taxes when I own nothing?
Okay, there you go. So but as we was growing up from children, probably pretty much everybody listening here, you know, heard the old saying, there's two things you can't avoid, death and taxes, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so you know that you can only be taxed if you claim ownership, so therefore to avoid taxes, you avoid ownership, okay? So my point is, well, if you can avoid taxes, and we've always been told that you can't avoid death and taxes, and I'm saying death is an illusion too. Now, does that mean that my heart won't stop beating and my flesh and blood body? But that's not who I am. I'm not
right.
the body.
That's what I wanted to go back to, you know, to define the difference between the body dying and the spirit. I wanted to bring that out. But anyway, yeah, go ahead. I hear you.
Yeah. My life is not the body. My life is, this is a chapter of my life in a certain physical structural form, you know, so
see Mike, right now you're getting to a fine line here, which I have a problem with too. My life, my spirit, it's, or could it be our spirit? We're all one spirit. The thing of it is, it's
don't
like,
you think you can be don't you think you can be an individual and collective as well? I mean, I played sports all my life on ball teams, and I never gave up my individuality to be part of a whole.
Right,
the whole
was it really your individuality, or was the way you was acting was because thoughts occurred at the moment?
Well, that's who creates what I am is my thoughts, and they're not my thoughts. Actually, I believe now that, you know, I can never have an original thought. There's not a thought that, you know, every thought comes from the Creator.
There
and
you go.
So it's not even my thought.
If it's true what they say, nothing new under the sun.
That's right. So I've never been an original creator of anything. You know, now I can take a thought, maybe an act on it or not act on it, and I got to, you know, discern, you know, where those thoughts are coming from to try to have a good life, which I believe my Creator wants me to have, you know, to,
well,
to be
the
happy.
Creation, yeah, I go with the creation. I'm trying to stay away from the possessive words. I call it the creation, and I believe I'm part of the creation, and I'm trying to stay in harmony with the creation without letting the ego get the upper hand, if that makes any sense.
Well, that's why we all have to do what works for us, and I wouldn't have, you know, be pretentious enough to try to tell you how to view things, as I hope, you know, and I respect you and know that you wouldn't be pretentious enough to try to tell me how to view things. It's good we have, you know, we can have dialogue and conversation, and I have learned from you and different things that I totally 100% agree with, you know, but to start to split with you because our viewpoints ain't 100% identical, you know, I don't think that's necessary to say, well, you're right and I'm wrong, or I'm wrong and you're right, and you know, about a minute detail that we all have a viewpoint on.
The thing of it is, I've learned the more I can ask questions, the smoother things go. Well, the thing of it is, you gotta ask questions. What I learned is when I ask a question, I try to think of it. Would that offend me if somebody asked me that question? See?
Yeah, I got something to that. I also agree that right now I'm dealing with a chapter that when this body dies, another chapter is going to be written somewhere else. And for anybody who honestly believes that, I guess my question would be, because it's a question I have to ask myself, when we move on to that next chapter, when we look back on the previous chapter, are we going to look back on that on this chapter that we're living right now as any better because we had more toys than everybody else?
Yeah.
You know, because when this chapter is said and done and we go on and, you know, I move on to the next one, well, the next one might have absolutely nothing to do with possessions or anything like that. And I look back on this chapter, am I going to be embarrassed by the fact that I chased after possessions in this chapter?
Well,
am I going to learn? Am I going to learn by it? Or as the Hindus believe, am I going to be in a less state? Am I going to be in a state where I'm going to be made to start back at zero because I had more toys in my possession when the body dies than everybody else? I mean, if you believe that there's something after this, and that you're going somewhere else, what does what you acquire in this lifetime mean anything to that? It's not going to disappear with you when that chapter begins and go to the next chapter. So what does all that mean?
Think of it as, can you count it all joy?
Hmm? Oh, it's all good.
Well then, what are you going to look back at, other than it's part of the education?
Yeah.
And if it's all good and you can count it all joy, that's another. You know, you're relieving a burden upon yourself, in my opinion, because you know, you got to forgive yourself, in my opinion, to move on. If you keep picking at bitterness, it's just going to fester, you know? Who's the problem?
The one I see in the one I'm looking at in the mirror right now.
Are you blaming the mirror? That's another question.
The answers to the universe are ours. We just have to know the right question to ask.
There you go. And listen, pay attention to the heart. Listen, universal internet is what I like to call it.
All the answers to the universe are on the inside because we are part of the universe. The universe isn't going to abandon us to ourselves. Isn't going to abandon us without all the information.
I think only if we insist, but that's another story.
I would agree with the idea of a universal consciousness, but I think that there's something even that goes beyond that. But I do agree with the universal consciousness, which is accessed through our sacred heart, not our brain. You know, I think our brain is just material, you know, matter. And I think it fears for this chapter of the life because it can't comprehend the net, you know, what's beyond this, you know, so it seeks to survive. And it tries to convince us of all kinds of things because it's a closed off intelligence. It, you know, it's confined. But if we access our higher intelligence through our heart, I read one time, if you try to solve the problems of your life using your brain, you will only dig yourself a deeper hole. Because that gray matter is basically a computer, and it doesn't understand forgiveness, and it doesn't understand the sacred. And so if you want to solve the problems of your life, go to your sacred heart. You know, your brain, like the government, can be a wonderful servant but a dreadful master.
Hey, could the brain be telling your sacred heart where she could be could it be the sacred heart, the universal heart?
I don't believe so. I think that they, I think the actual sacred heart, I think our physical heart is just a symbolism. I think our sacred heart is actually located almost in the center of our spine, depending on, you know, it might be a little higher, might be a little lower, but I think it's there. It's that door to see. I read once, you know, we're always looking for the extra dimension. What if we are the other dimension in this outer world? And see, I don't believe going beyond, you know, looking outwardly for my sacred heart. I have to go inwardly. And there's a difference between the inner and the outer. And that's therein lies the crux for us to balance the inner with the outer. You know, I think blessings and miracles, I think our Creator would love nothing better than to bless us. I think, like you said, we're our own worst enemy. We try to solve things ourselves instead of getting out of His way so He can fix things, so He can do and give us what... I think we've already been given everything we could ever have. You know, it's already been given to us. Everything we could ever need, want, or even dream of has already been given to us. Our problem is we haven't got ourselves in the right place to receive it. And so it's not that it's, you know, I'm waiting for Him to give it to me. In my heart, I know He already has. And I'm my own worst enemy, like you said. I got to get out of His way. You know, it's not for Him to take, you know, things from me, bad things from me. It's for me to give them up to Him. If I don't let go of them, He can't take them. But I've seen amazing things happen when you let go. And I think He's just waiting to bless us. I think that's why they want to keep us in a constant state of fear, which is what? False evidence appearing real. You know, so that we hate and we despise and we want to get even. You know, one thing I've learned, Batman, over the last year is it's easier. The more I learn about what the law really is, even on their side, even in the world, the less mad I have to be, because, you know, the law is there. We'll protect us if we know it, I think, because I think there are people in certain places that know that all too well. And when we start being judgmental and hating these lawyers and judges and stuff, and I just boarded a judge's dog. I've known him for a couple of years now, worked with his dog, and he came out here the other day and picked up his dog. He's a retired judge. And I was talking to him about, you know, how he had no power under the 11th Amendment and you know, their law. You know, that's what I love about, you know, it's easier for me to remind them of who they're not than for me to go in there and tell them who I am. You know, not that I want to go in anywhere. You know, hope I never find myself in a situation. And I know your viewpoint on that, you know, how you would handle that. But my point is the more that I learn, you know, I want to help my brothers and sisters. I'm not out here to hurt them. I'm not out here to judge them. But I'm not going to be a doormat either. And the more knowledge I feel, that helps me to be in a better position not to be a doormat. And they rule on intimidation and fear. And we was talking about driving, and he said, what's the definition of driving? And, you know, the state statute definition, that thing you judge, that you say you judge and have authority over. What's the definition of driving? Well, he couldn't tell me. He said, I don't know.
I can tell you. Definition of driving is anybody who believes they're driving. And if it depends how they answer and handle the situation at the moment. But anyway, go ahead.
And he said, I don't know what it is. You know, it's getting in behind the wheel of your car and getting out there on the road. And I said, that ain't the definition. I was asking him what the state statute definition was, okay? You know, not what he believed the definition is. I mean, he used to be a judge. He ought to know what the definitions of the state statutes are, right?
It sounded like he hit it right on the nail when he said, when you go out there and get in your car, you're driving. But anyway, go ahead.
Anyway, he didn't know. You'd think a judge would know the definitions of the statutes. So he couldn't tell me. And he said, well, if you come in before me, you know, if one of these officers, you know, and you was, you know, put before me, he said, I'd throw you in jail. And I said, you throw me in jail and you can't even tell me what the definition of driving is by your state, by the state statutory definition of driving is, you know? And I said, so anyway, but basically what he was trying to use, you know, was fear and intimidation. You know, the first thing he went to when he got caught not knowing something he probably should know for the position he held was, what's the statutory definition of driving? I mean, if you're going to be a judge of these things, you should know.
Sounds like you're a mind reader to me. To me, the judge's job is very simple. Anybody who comes in there claiming a name has brought a controversy before the court and just gave the court jurisdiction. That's all he needs there, or she, whatever. Other than that, it's all freaking bullshit. It's all a matter of staying in honor. You claimed ownership. There's a controversy. The creation, everything belongs to the creation. You want to cause division? Claim the name. There you go. That's all the judge needs to hear, in my humble opinion. That's my experience, anyway. Thinking free. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm not that
much. Hey, it's working.
Yep, it's working.
How you been doing?
Different thing?
What's that?
It comes up with a number instead of, you know, your usual Batman thing.
Yeah, I called in to Skype. I called in through Skype to talk to you, so just in case, you know, people from across the pond call in, I can add them in through Skype. And
yeah, okay.
It's a little muffled here and there. Hopefully others are hearing you. I hear you so.
Hello. I've just had I've just had somebody from the estate agent at the door.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, this call is being recorded through TalkShoe at the moment, so I just figure in case. Usually we have a pretty good generic conversation anyway, but I just thought I'd mention it to you. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. They came to they tried to drill the door because they came to change the lock. So I opened the door and I was like, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Oh, we've come to change the locks." I said, "Oh yeah." And he said, "I said, why are you doing that?" And he said, "Well, this house has been repossessed." I said, "Has it?" And he said, "Yeah." And I said, "Oh." And he said, "Oh yeah, I go, where's your evidence of that? Have you got any evidence of that?" And he said, "Yeah, an order." And I said, "Can I see it, please?" He said, "Well, he said, I haven't got it." And I said, "Well, what gives you the authority to come here and change the lock then? Have you got some more authority? Can you show me some authority?" And he says, "I don't need it. The estate agent sent me." And I said, "Okay, yes, but I'd like to see some authority." And he goes, "Well, I know you're the one, you know." I know you know what I'm talking about. I can tell by the way you are. And I said, "Can you?" And he said, "Yeah." And I said, and then he walked off then, and he said, no, he took a picture of me, took a photograph of me. He just put his camera up, he took a camera phone. And I thought, what's he doing with that? Next minute, he took a picture and went, "Thanks." And then he went to his friend. "Come on then, let's go and call the police."
Yeah.
And after went.
You moved back into the house, you're telling me?
Yeah, I said, "I'm using it."
Beautiful. You moved back in. There you go.
Yeah.
I love you, baby. You're doing it.
Yeah, I said, "I'm using it. What do you mean? I'm using it." And he was like... "It's been repossessed, you know." And I was like, "Well, where's your evidence of that?"
Yeah, By who?
And he couldn't give me no evidence, and he couldn't give me no authority. And then he just left, trying to leave me in fear by saying he was calling the police. But he didn't even say me.
Yeah.
Why was he calling the police? He didn't, even ask me to leave.
It's all part of the test.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're either using it or claiming ownership. You're claiming ownership, the creator, I call it the left hand of God, is going to slap you right upside the head, man. Staying honored, you're going to find yourself in the right hand of God, and nobody's going to touch you when you get there. That's the kind of way I look at it. But
yeah.
If you're there now, that's a whole other story.
Mm-hmm.
But good to hear you back there. That's good.
Yeah, it's only a few days now.
People abandoned the property, man. You know.
Yeah. That's it. They abandoned it. That's what they did. I thought when they come to take out a peaceful inhabitant, I thought there must have been an emergency that they couldn't talk about because of to protect the public. And it turns out they're just leaving the building empty and open to attack Batman. What's going on there?
Beautiful. It's real simple, too. Easy. Another story, but simple. Where's all the fucking paperwork you filed, huh?
Yeah.
You know?
Uh-huh.
First-hand testimony is all you've been doing. It was.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Good to hear.
Yeah, it's all right. I was moving, you know. I've got nerves of steel now, Batman. I've actually got titanium balls. They actually are titanium now.
You got a heart of gold. That's what it is. A heart of gold, man. And an impenetrable fortress of love. Think about it. Feels good, huh?
Yeah, it certainly does. It really, really does.
Guess six is high, Wendy. Wendy's not on the computer. Guess six. Guess six says hi, Wendy. I'm not sure who guess six is. So.
Oh, yeah. Hi, guess six. You are a friend anyway, whoever you are.
I appreciate you giving me the good news, because I was concerned. I'm glad to hear. I think you're going to be okay.
They've cut the water supply, though, Batman.
Well, I'd be asking who had the authority to do that. That's what I'd be asking.
They actually sliced through the pipe.
Well, they ought to get somebody up there to fix it. You wouldn't want anybody to die at thirst because of something stupid they authorized now, would you?
You know what, Batman? I can't even water the garden, you know, and all the flowers that I've grown from the seed and put out there, they're all, like, getting really shriveled because they desperately need water. And the veg.
Well, tell them things are dying because of you guys. You sure you want to accept the liability? I want to know who authorized this turn off the water to this place. I think they ought to get here and fix it. If somebody dies on account of it, I want to know who authorized it being turned off.
Mm-hmm.
Try it. It might work. They might be right up there and fix it for you.
Yeah.
Where did they get
Where would I go with that, Batman?
Whoever supplies the water. City water, whatever. I'd notify them. It appears there's a break in the pipe here, man. I think you guys, it's outside the house where they broke it.
No, it's inside the house.
Inside the house.
The locksmith did it.
Well, break the lock and turn it on.
I can't turn the water off.
You can't turn it off.
No, it's really weird. I can't turn the water off by the stopcock. And he couldn't turn it off, so he's cut the pipe and put an end on it. So now if we cut the end off, all the water will come spinning out because there's no end on the stop cock to turn it.
You got any friends? You got any friends that come in there and fix it for you?
No, I don't think I have. I might do. I'll ask around.
Yeah, say I got a problem with the water, man. This thing wouldn't turn off, and they put a cap on it. Can you fix it for me?
Yeah.
That's probably it. Yeah. If I was there, I'd do it for you. But I'm not that good at swimming at the moment. So.
Yeah, I'll sort it some way. Not a problem. Well, it's only minor thing. I'll just ask the universe.
Yeah.
And the universe will provide the answer for me.
You got what you need.
Yeah, you know? I have. So Steve lives 2 doors up, so I can go the loo round there and have a bath round there and have a shower round there. And I drink bottled water anyway, so.
Yeah.
It's all right. I'm not bothered.
You're still there, man.
Still there.
It's, you know, and I think they're getting a message. I knew they were going to test you because, you know, the more I think, you know, this is a growing process. I believe when you were in the courtroom, though, well, if you could have talked to the bank beforehand, might have helped. And when you was in the courtroom with the bankster there, or the lawyer, I would have asked him, man, is this guy giving first-hand testimony? That's what I'd want to know.
Yeah.
Other than that, when you don't ask the question, the judge goes on to preponderance of the evidence. Simple little question like that. And another thing I think is a good term is, I wish. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I wish I could stay at this place. Any objections? See?
Yeah.
Nobody objects? Judge, what's the problem?
Uh-huh.
It's funny how these guys come around with no paperwork, huh?
Yeah, yeah. Even the bailiffs who came around, you know, they didn't have the order.
Yeah.
They had nothing. They had nothing.
Maybe the judge is a little shy. Maybe the judge doesn't want to put his so-called signature on anything.
Yeah.
It's the test, you know. It's the people's opinions. That's all a judge gives is his opinion. Whose fault? Who's the idiot if you believe it, you know?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah. You know, if you want to sit there and let a judge who you've never met before tell you who you are, then you deserve it.
Yeah, I know who you are. You know who I am, huh? You must be a mind reader. All good.
Yeah. They go to the neighbours, you know, and get testimony off the neighbours and everything of who I am, you know. Like, they can give them...
Yeah, that's all bullshit.
Yeah, yeah. Cool.
But, you know, but that's all, you know, people are stupid, man. We're all stupid, just at different levels. You know, I liked it last time I got arrested here. They kept asking the boy, you know, I'll say my boy for the sake of conversation, you know, what's your dad's name? Kept asking him. And he just said, he's right over there. Why don't you ask him? Boy, they had a problem with that.
How beautiful is that? How beautiful is that?
Yeah, he was only 16 at the time, and it was great. He did better than I did. I screwed up, got arrested. He didn't. They let him go.
Cool, man. That's what he did. Kids can get it better. That's how kids argue. You know, if you listen to small children arguing, they will make you. They're like, prove it. They're going, prove it. You know what I mean? And everything. They really come down hard on you to come out with the truth.
Yeah. Well, they're going to persecute you, you know?
Yeah.
But children, man, children, I tell you, they know better than the grown-ups. You know, I have one guy on a call the other night. His boy's 11 years old, and he can't do it. I said, bullshit, he can't do it. He can't be a witness. What do you mean? You take a 5-year-old, if he accuses somebody of being a child molester, they take his testimony, right? Come on.
Yeah.
Mm. Stand point.
Yeah, they're great kids, though. They really are. Go, teacher.
Anybody can join back in if they like. I'd do away with this. Dr. Erdman, let me unmute you. Hey, Dr. Erdman. You there?
Yeah, I'm there. Muted.
Yeah, you ought to talk with Wendy. She'll tell you how to stay in that big house of yours.
Oh, yeah? Where's she from?
She's across the pond. We've been talking quite a bit for a little while now. Sure, they evicted what they thought was a tenant, but she moved back in. And they have yet to move her out. There's another guy that did it. Who's got the claim? Difference between being a homeowner or an inhabitant. That's all it really comes down to. The thing of it is, can you act like an inhabitant? That's the question. If you think you own it, I think you're screwed. Right, Wendy?
Yep, definitely. You gotta let go of that shit, man. Definitely. That ownership.
What do you think about sending the bills to the owner of the name, the comptroller?
Give it a shot. See what
okay.
happens.
I tried that.
Yeah.
Didn't work. They wrote and told me it's not their department.
That could be. The other thing is, though, when they send you any, and in my opinion, they send you any thing in the matter of the water bills or anything, I just answer them. If they're sending you a shut-off notice, I just send them back one question. Well, tell me who's authorizing to shut it off. I'd like to help settle this matter honorably. That's all. Because who authorized it to be turned on?
Well, it doesn't get shut off.
Yeah. They just cut the pipe on you.
When you move into a property over here, all the supplies are on, all the services, the gas, the electric and the water, they're not cut off. And then it's up to you to go to the company to tell them who you are, and then they start billing you. That's how it works here. So it's never shut off unless, like, obviously you authorise it through, you know, not being a peaceful inhabitant or whatever, not paying the bill.
But the thing of it is, though, you could point it out, I believe I'm a peaceful inhabitant using this stuff. Thing of it is, it's a natural resource, man. It's like a river running by your house.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason they're going to shut it off is because nobody's answering. Why waste the water? Or you're arguing with them. You're claiming ownership. Point of the matter is, who authorized it to turn on? An individual needed to use this stuff. I called, you turned it on. Now I want to know who's authorizing to turn it off. It all goes through a company. And anybody that claims they were authorized to turn it off, there's only one reason, in my opinion, that they're clear. Because nobody responded, there's nobody at home. So nobody's being damaged by it being turned off. If you answer them, it says, like, what a question, Who's authorizing the shutoff? I'd like to speak with him to help settle this matter. I believe you keep answering them like that with every bill. Good chance I say they won't turn it off. Something to consider. Until you can find, you know, I know there's a better way to do it. But in general, that's just answering them right to the point. Until they give a shutoff notice, though. If you don't answer a shutoff notice, they're going to assume nobody's there. And they'll act on it. Whether it's right or wrong, well, who's to say? But if you keep answering them with the questions, you might find they won't ever turn it off until you stop answering them. Something to consider. What do you think, Tim? Or Dr. Herb? I know, I was running on. I lose you? Yeah, send a bill to the Queen. There you go. Send it to the Pope. He's the vicar for Christ. He's the one. Yeah, he's the one handling the affairs. Anybody claims ownership of God's shit, he's there to jump on your ass. It's like, gee, I didn't. What evidence you have? I claimed ownership there, Mr. Vicar, Mr. Pope. Is it a crime if I'm just using it? That might settle it. Could it be that simple? If nobody's going to speak up, I'm going to play a song. I need to take a break. I'll be back after the song.
Cool.
Any objections?
No.
Let's see what
play away.
All right. Let's see what I want to play next here. Figure something out here. There we go.
Oh,
Call in guest 7, we'll discuss the matter. Oh, Strider. Okay, got you, buddy. Ask him, you know, hospital bills like that and stuff are easy, and collection agencies, man, I could send a letter. Well, I've had experience and helped people with sending letters to collection agencies, and they just go away. Just ask a couple questions. Either, no big deal.
How about it, Steve? Probably a better way.
What's that?
I say, I've got the same experience with that. If you just ask them a question, you never hear from them again.
Pretty much, yep.
Batman, this is Strider. I think I told you, with help from you and your old bill of particulars, a lawyer was coming after the name for 2 credit cards and eventually just bumped it, and it actually filed for a court date. But eventually didn't do anything and just bumped it back to the credit card company. And now they're sending out bills to the name again. The credit card company is doing it. Well, the same lawyer, I guess they really don't. Check their check to see what, you know, what debts they're taking on, quote unquote. But they sent out another claim on the name for a different credit card company. So we got to go through this again.
What's a stamp and a little letter and an envelope? Just freaking.
Yeah. It's like, don't you guys even check? Come on now.
You'll get the swing of it.
Yeah.
I was around. I'd be glad to help settle the matter. The thing of it is, who's got a claim on the name? Huh?
And I haven't heard anything from the so-called state of Georgia on state taxes now for 8 months.
Interesting.
They haven't. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I'm just saying, you just asked a few questions, try to help settle the matter, right?
Yeah, I did go. I did go in there once, you know, to hold on. I did go in there a few months back to because I didn't really, I really didn't know what was going on, and I wanted to just help settle the matter and everything, and they couldn't get me out of there quick enough. They're like, the questions you're asking, you can just leave now. Okay, I'm like, okay.
Well, then, what you might want to say, well, I trust you'll settle this matter honorably.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, what I did do back in February, when I the tax forms went out for the year 2010 for the name,
yeah.
I put them all in a manila envelope, and I wrote a little letter to the mailed them to the local IRS office, wrote a little letter saying, you know, here are your forms, I trust anything, you know, I trust you'll take care of this, anything that arises, I know you'll take care of honorably. And here you go. And I put a phone number down there. I said, if you have any questions that I can help with, you know, you can call this number and I'll see what I can do. And about 45 days later, they sent me out they sent a letter out to the name saying, we're going to need another 45 days to investigate this. In the meantime, and then about 30 days after that, they sent out to the name copies of all of those tax forms back with something saying, and it was in the most illegible handwriting. The wife and I took a good 10 minutes trying to figure out what they had written, saying a 1040 needs to be filled out for this. But, you know, I thought it was interesting that they sent back copies and kept the originals. And then this is a month and a half ago, and then Monday a letter came from the name from the IRS again saying we need another 45 days to investigate this. take care of what you need to take care of. If you need me, give me a call. Whatever.
Yeah.
If I can help, I'll help.
You're not arguing with them. How can I help you? That's all. It's too simple.
Yeah, so we'll see. I'm sure 45 days from now, or sooner, something else will come on, and we'll see. If they settle the matter, decide they want to, give a little test, or just decide to keep extending it. Whatever they want to do, that's fine. I mean, It's their information anyway. So,
it's all our information. It's all there for us to use. They're just looking for people claiming ownership. And when you ask the questions and stuff, how can I help you? And what do you need? Where's the controversy? You're meeting them. The last place they want to do is bring that before a judge. Because I've been trying to help these guys. What's this? What do you need testimony for before the court? What evidence do you have? You see?
Right.
That's all it really is. To me, anyway. It's that simple. Damn point. I'm not, you're not saying I won't do anything. You're not saying I don't owe this.
Yeah.
Here's the argument.
Yeah. It's pretty simple. No one...
The hard part is getting over yourself. That's the hard part.
The way I look at it is, as long as you're not throwing any negativity, as long as you're not throwing any negativity out there, you're not going to get any negativity back.
I agree. Yeah.
So,
you get what you put out. Yeah.
That's the way I see it. I mean, I could be wrong.
Heck, so could I. What the fuck do I know?
Sky is beautiful right now. About 97 degrees right now, and the sky is just beautiful.
It's not here today as well.
Say that again?
Okay, it's been nice here as well today.
Oh. Must get good wind off the water there, huh?
Yeah, it has been a bit windy, actually. Picked up this afternoon.
I'm a little far inland for the really good ocean breezes. I used to have ocean breezes down in the Miami Fort Lauderdale area. That was a lot of fun, but I'm a ways away from the ocean right now.
Yeah, same here. I'm in the middle of England, right in the centre, so you couldn't be further away from the sea wherever I am in England. Which is only 70 miles, by the way. It's not very far, to the nearest sea here.
How wide is England? How wide is that land at its widest point?
It's hard to say. I'd say probably about 350 miles, something like that. 400.
Yeah.
3/4 miles, anyway.
Yeah, I'm about... probably 100 and... No, I think it's roughly 120 miles inland, I think. We're gearing up for, they say it's not going to come out of the 90s here during the day for another week and a half.
Ooh,
and it's going to mostly be in the high 90s, so. Yeah. Considering the winter that we had, which is not normal for this area. Yeah. It's it'll be
over the world.
It'll be nice.
I've seen some quite remarkable sights in Canada at the sea. You know, freezing and everything. That was mad. Yeah, it was a crazy old winter, that's for sure.
Here we are, 3 miles, 30,000 miles apart. We're talking about the weather.
Well, you know, the Brits.
I'm in, they call it the land of Georgia in the south of the United States, so-called.
Oh, yeah. Well,
and,
the Brits are meant to always talk about the weather.
Yeah, from what I understand, the weather changes with the minute there.
That's it. That's like such a big talking point. You get four seasons in one day here.
that sounds like San Francisco here in the States.
All part of the fun.
What do you music?
Good for an art garden, anyway.
Batman, you there?
Oh, yeah. Everybody left except Wendy and you.
Oh.
Maybe. Oh, and we got Metacomet 11 there, or whatever. Call it in. Enlighten us. He's on the computer, I believe.
I need something new. I need to learn something new every day. Actually, I already learned a lot new today, but I'll learn some more. Oh, my goodness. There's so much construction around here. These folks complain that they don't have any so-called money, yet they can't stop building things.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I've got no money enough.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Wendy. Go ahead.
I said I've got no money, and I'm glad.
It definitely, when you let go of it, it's definitely freeing. And then you get to watch other people. You get to step out on the outside and watch other people act the way you did. And you're like, oh shit, that's the way I used to act.
Yeah, that's the one. Wow, that was me.
Yeah.
And I'm dead glad I'm not there now.
All we need is what we need.
Yeah,
as long as we have what we need, the joy should
that's
be
it.
There.
And I have everything I need. In fact, I'm just about to light it up now. So they all gone, Batman?
I'm still here.
Are they all gone, though?
We got people.
I'm gonna have to mute here for a few minutes. Muting out.
We got, like I say, we got Strider and Metacomet 11, but other than that, it's just that's it. I don't know. Had quite a few people drop in, but looks like they all dropped out. I guess maybe
yeah.
It's simple for them. Who knows?
Have you heard from Drew today at all?
Who?
Drew.
Joyce?
Drew.
Drew? Did I recall? Or Dwight, you mean?
He had one of the, you know, the nice bailiff that you talked to?
Oh, no, I haven't heard from him in a while.
Well, that nice bailiff who comes round to speak to him came round the other day and told him that the bank had applied for a writ of something or other, and that they were going to come round this morning at 10 o'clock, to, you know, to smash in the door and take out anybody that's in there.
Talk is cheap. Maybe they want to see if they'll leave. Who knows?
Yeah, maybe. But anyway, that was apparently at 10 o'clock this morning, so I just wondered, because he's not on now, and I just wondered if anybody'd heard anything about him.
I haven't. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Well, shoot. Hopefully he's all right.
Yeah, he'd be all right. Whatever.
Gonna play another song, see if anybody comes in. You care to hear another song? Let's see what I can, because I need to make a phone call. Let's see, what can I play? There's a good song. From one of the guys from across the pond. I like this song.
Never.